Because, folks, it's all about what Jesus did for us. If it wasn't for Jesus dying on the cross for us, there is no salvation. The fact is that even from the cross, those words of Jesus have some significant teaching for us. And so that's what we want to look at. So the first one is when Jesus actually forgives. Now that's very significant. Jesus was tortured. He was put on a cross. If anybody had the rights and the reasons to be a little ticked off, it was Jesus. He was wrongfully accused. He was beaten down. They scourged him with the cat of nine tails. Well, actually a whip, but basically that's where the cat of nine tails came from, that concept. It was long strands of leather with pieces of stuff in it that would actually rip the skin off you. And that's what Jesus endured for our sake. So now then they come and they nail him on a cross in between two common criminals. And Jesus, the first thing he says, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Not sure it's the first thing that would come to my mind. But for Jesus, it was very, very important. Had he not chosen to forgive at that point, the enemy would have swooped in at the end, right at the end of Jesus' life, and would have scooped up a big victory. Because when Jesus chose to forgive, it took all of the bitterness away. It took all of the grounds that the enemy was hoping for at that time, and he took it away. So the forgiveness aspect is very, very huge in our walk with Jesus. A lot of the material I'll be using today comes right out of study that I've taken with LL Ministries in our prayer ministry training. So there may be some things that you'll recognize. That's okay. It bears repeating. So let's take a look, first of all, at the passage of Scripture. It's probably going to be one that we're going to read several times throughout the next little while. Please stand together with me as we read through about Jesus' crucifixion. And when they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him, that's Jesus, and the criminals. One on the right and the other on the left. But Jesus was saying, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. And they cast lots, dividing up his garments among themselves. And the people stood by looking on. And even the rulers were sneering at him, saying, he saved others, let him save himself, if this is the Christ of God, his chosen one. The soldiers also mocked him, coming up to him, offering him sour wine, and saying, if you are the King of the Jews, save yourself. Now there was also an inscription above him. This is the King of the Jews. I want to take another look at another passage of Scripture. It comes from Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 17. Because Jesus now teaches us through his servant Paul about where we're supposed to be on this whole forgiveness thing. So as those who have been chosen by God, or of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, bearing with one another and forgiving each other, whoever has a complaint against anyone, just as the Lord forgave you, so also should you. Beyond all these things, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ richly dwell within you, with all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another, with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, saying with thankfulness in your heart to God, whatever you do in the word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. Lord, bless the reading of his word. Be seated. Father, we are dependent upon you to speak into our hearts today. You spoke from the cross. But Lord, those significant words are very important to us as well. Help us, Lord, to understand them. Help us, Lord, to practice them. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. So Luke chapter 23, verse 34, it says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing, or know not what they do. Jesus models, right from the cross, Jesus models the attitude that we need to take towards those who have hurt us, those who have caused damage within our lives. It nowhere does it say that we're supposed to hold on to it, hold grudges, hold on to our rights and reasons, and make them pay. It doesn't say that. What it does say is that we're to walk in forgiveness. Easy? No, it's not easy. Matter of fact, everything that is in our human spirit cries out against that. But you don't know what they did to me, right? They've got to pay. And Jesus models forgiveness from the cross. If anybody had rights and reasons to be upset, it was Jesus who took upon himself our sin. He was paying the price for us. And yet he says, Father, forgive them. Jesus teaches forgiveness in the Lord's Prayer. You notice at the end of the Lord's Prayer, actually, is the first thing that disturbs me. I'm okay with it now, but at first it really disturbed me. It says, if you do not forgive others, God the Father cannot forgive you. Ouch. Right? You mean, if I choose to hold an offense against those people who've hurt me over the years, then in fact I'm lost? Yes. That's what the Word says. That if we choose not to walk in forgiveness, if we choose to hold bitterness in our hearts, then in fact, we are stuck. It's not God that won't forgive, it's us. And because of our choice of not forgiving, he cannot forgive us. Now, you know why it disturbed me? Because I wanted God's forgiveness, but I wasn't too sure I wanted to forgive those people who hurt me. Now I've come to a place of understanding it a little bit better. That when we choose to forgive other people, we're setting ourselves free. I'll get to that more later on. Forgiveness is the central aspect in the Lord's Supper. When the Lord comes to the table, that forgiveness aspect was there as well. One other aspect we see here is forgiveness is a direction or a directive that was given to the disciples upon Jesus' resurrection. When Jesus first, right, the first thing he says to his apostles is, when you choose to forgive somebody on earth, I will choose to forgive them as well. If you choose not to forgive them, I choose not to forgive them as well. That's what it says. And so we recognize that this forgiveness thing is a huge issue in the teachings of Jesus. Therefore, as followers of Jesus, forgiveness needs to be a very principal point for us to look at. And yet it's one of the easiest things for trip on. I've said it over and over and over that forgiveness is the gateway to all healing. If you want healing in your life, it's time to walk in forgiveness. Not easy. But nowhere in Scripture did it say being a follower of Jesus was going to be easy. That's just the North American easy believism. But truly, when we get to Scripture, matter of fact, God says that in this life you will have trouble. Take heart. I have overcome the world. So when we walk in Christ, it doesn't mean that it's going to be home free and no problems. What it means is that Jesus is going to walk with us and he is going to help us in this process. Well, why do we need to forgive? Well, there's a number of reasons. The first thing is that when we choose to forgive other people, it transforms our relationship with God. We recognize that when we looked at the bottom of the Lord's Prayer, that if we choose not to forgive, God can't forgive us. So when we choose to forgive, it changes our relationship with God. And so now God says, good, now my forgiveness is upon you as well. And so what we want to do is we want to have that transformed relationship with him. And so to be forgiven. Second thing is it releases the power of the Holy Spirit into our lives. That's where that healing comes from. See, because when we've been damaged by someone, there's not just the fact that we need to speak the words, oh, Father, I choose to forgive so-and-so for whatever. But then the Holy Spirit is released to come and do a healing work deep inside of our spirit. Because we've been crushed in our spirit when people have hurt us or when we've taken offense. And what God wants to do is he wants to heal us from that. So it's not just a case of, oh, yeah, I forgive them. And I find that those words are awfully glib and very often spoken without really feeling the emotions deep down inside. But when we actually come to the point of processing through what the person has actually done to us, feeling it again, and saying, Lord, I choose to forgive and not hold them accountable any longer, then the Holy Spirit can start to do a work inside of us and heal us up. I'll be getting to more of that in a few moments. The third thing it does is it restores our soul. I have an illustration that I do with young people quite often. It includes chains and locks and keys. Do I have a couple of volunteers? It's not bondage, honestly. So, Fred, we will make you the offended. So you've been offended. So do you want to just put this chain around your neck? Let's just take one in. And then I'm going to lock it on there. We want it locked on so that you can't slip it up over your hair. Yeah, I see that. This one's a little different. It's got a little bit different jewelry on it. Now, you're the offender, so this one just goes around your wrist. And we'll give you some jewelry as well. All right. Now, what's happened is Fred has taken offense. Something that Norma Jean has done was wounded him deeply. And he has taken offense. Now, he has every right and reason. He's got a claim of justice against Norma Jean. But the problem is, as long as he doesn't choose to forgive Norma Jean, Norma Jean has him on a short leash. And so he can... could be a fairly short leash. But so what happens then is all the time that forgiveness has not happened, every time that Fred thinks of the issue, or even thinks of Norma Jean's name, it's like a tug on the leash. Don't do it too hard.
No.
It is raining again. Okay? So now what happens, though, is when we choose to forgive someone, what we do is, Lord, I choose to forgive some of Fred's doing. Lord, I choose to forgive Norma Jean. And then what happens is God gives him a key. Now, first thing that people are going to do is unlock their own chain, right? I want to be free, Lord. I want to be free. Does it work? Need help? Yeah, I made it nice and close to his neck on purpose. But this one doesn't work. So where does that one go to then? Who's he setting free?
Yeah, right.
No, but what he does, though, is in setting Norma Jean free, what he does is, Lord, I choose to forgive Norma Jean. And that one unlocks her chain. So no longer is the leash it's no longer on a leash. He's just got a chain around his neck. So the next thing he wants to pray, though, is he wants to go on further. So, Lord, I want to be free. I want to be set free. The Holy Spirit comes along. I'm a poor representation, but the Holy Spirit comes along and sets him free. That is the whole concept of forgiveness. As long as we choose not to forgive a person who's offended us, we're giving them permission to continue to hurt us. Because they've got us on that leash. So important for us to set those people free. By the way, just so that you know, we're setting them free from off our hook, not off of God's. They still have to answer to God. Okay? It opens the door for God's healing. That's what I showed with that second key when I came and unlocked Fred's chain. It opens the door for God's healing. And then it transforms our relationship with other people. Given enough time, I won't go back to that relationship, but when I chose to forgive my dad, when I was growing up, many of you know my testimony, when I was growing up, I thought when my dad spoke to us very often, he spoke two languages very, very well. First was English, the second was profane. And so I thought my name started with "you stupid son of a." That's what I thought about, because that's what we got a lot. And so when I chose to forgive my dad, God came and set me free. I started to see my dad through a totally different eyes. And as I started to see him through different eyes, the relationship that I have now with my father is far better than it ever was before. God wants to restore relationships. Now, not in every situation is he going to restore a relationship to where you're going to be best friends or that kind of thing. In situations of abuse and whatnot, we're not saying that you have to be reconciled to that person who abused you in the past. But rather, there is no longer any bite. There is no longer the bitterness and hatred towards that person. But rather, God can change that relationship. Do you understand? Okay, so let's carry on. Well, who do we need to forgive? See, now that's where we really get down to the teaching. Well, who do we need to forgive? Well, the first thing we need to do is recognize that that there's going to be some significant people in our lives. Significant people would first of all be our ancestors. Did your ancestors do anything that would require forgiveness? Now, you don't have, generally, we don't have to look down from far down the line to see this kind of thing. It says that the sins of the fathers come down to the third and fourth generation. Here's something for you, sexual sin to the 10th generation. How many of us have to go back 10 generations to find sexual sin? None of us. It's rampant. So what we recognize then is that there's a generational inheritance that has come down the family line, whether it be towards anger, a disposition towards anger, a disposition towards greed, or whatever it is, there's going to be something. So one of the things we may have to do is we have to choose to forgive those in our immediate family. Mom and Dad, who was raised here with perfect parents? Mom and Dad were perfect. So nobody was born with absolutely perfect parents. So we may think that, you know what, I was pretty blessed. I was pretty blessed. But the fact is, we probably will have to forgive our parents for something. Make sure they're down on your list. Also, there's going to be some authority figures. That could be a school teacher. I had to forgive a school teacher just because of the attitude she had towards my twin brother and I. And I took an offense. It wasn't necessarily what she had done, but it was the offense that I took. So there's some of those kinds of authority figures as well. So those are some of the kinds of people we need to put down. But there's going to be some other people as well that we'll probably have to walk in forgiveness. There's going to be those people who have hurt you. Anybody here with bullying in school? You don't have to put up your hand. I get it. Yeah, but there is that kind of concept. And so there's people who have hurt us in our past, whether it be abuses, whether it be spiritual abuse by a pastor or by other religious leaders, or whether it's a physical abuse, whatever the issue is, there are people there that have hurt us in our past. And as long as we don't walk in forgiveness, we are still attached to them by that chain. And we still give them permission to hurt us. In other words, every time we think of them, it all comes right back, and we're back in that place when they were hurting us before. The third persons we need to forgive is ourselves. How many people hold yourself to blame for where you're at today? Man, I did such stupid things. And we can blame ourselves for the things that have gone wrong. So we may have to forgive ourselves. And one that we don't often think about is we may have to forgive God. Is that because God did something wrong? No. How many of us have blamed God for something? Yeah. And so we need to ask God to forgive us for blaming him. Because he can't do anything wrong. But we sometimes think he has. So what I've set up before us is 7 steps to forgiveness. And I want to start by looking at the significance or the benefit that is ours when we walk in that forgiveness. So I've got a passage of scripture for us to read. It's in Psalm 19, 7 through 11. And it goes this way. The law of the Lord is perfect, restoring the soul. Isn't that what we want? The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true. They are righteous altogether. And I missed a couple parts there. It's also sweeter than the honey. In the honeycomb. Is it still there? Oh. How about that? There they are. Yes, and much fine gold, sweeter also than the honey and the drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them your servant is warned, in keeping them there's great reward. So there's a benefit to us when we walk in God's ways. So what's step one? Well, step one in this pathway or journey is to make a decision. Now, if we wait until we feel like forgiving somebody, when will we do it?
Never.
It's not going to happen. See, forgiveness is not about feelings. It's about choice. Now, when will we do that, make that choice? When we're sick and tired of being sick and tired. That's typically when this starts, is I'm so sick and tired of constantly being depressed, thinking about being lesser than, or whatever. So basically it comes down to when we're sick and tired of being sick and tired, that's when we're going to actually start this process and make decisions. You know what, I've got to do something about this. This has just been too long coming. And so we choose to make the choice. You choose whether you're ready to let the other person off the hook. Off your hook. Remember, what you're doing is you're setting them free, not necessarily for their benefit, you're setting them free for your benefit, so that you can be free. So you're ready to let off their hook as well, as it were. And then in Colossians chapter 3, it says, bearing with one another and forgiving each other, whoever has complained against anyone, just as the Lord forgave you, so also you should. So the first thing is, we've got to make that decision. I'm so tired of carrying this load around forever. Now it's time. It's time. Step two. It's time now to make a list. And so as we go to make that list, first thing we need to do is pray. Because I remember when I was first going to make my list, I said, well, Lord, who in the world am I going to put down here? And for the life of me, I couldn't think of people. And then I asked God to help me with this. And the prayer goes something like this. Thank you, Jesus, for teaching me the importance of forgiving others. Please help me remember all the people in my life who have hurt me so I can forgive them from my heart. And all of a sudden, the floodgates opened and names came to mind. And that's when you start writing down. You begin, first way to begin is go get a piece of paper and a pen. Anticipate that God's going to bring names to you. Then begin with your parents, because it will be generational inheritance. Then write down every name that God brings to your mind. And when you write down the name, remember at least to title the infraction. Because basically, later on it's going to be, Lord, I choose to forgive so-and-so for, and you don't need to go into long details and whatnot of what they've done. But you do need to, I call it, headlining it. So just headline it. You know, this. I'm choosing to forgive my dad for rejecting me, or abandoning me, or something like that. So you don't have to go into a long, long tirade of the different things, but rather the significant thing. So you write down every name that comes to mind. This is for the benefit of the analyzers. Do not overanalyze. If you overanalyze, you will start to rationalize why they did what they did, and you will take them off your list. I don't need to forgive them because of where they were in their life at that time, it was why they did this to me and whatnot. I can just let that go. Don't overanalyze. If God brought the name, write the name, write the infraction, we'll deal with it. It'll be fine. Don't forget to include your own name. So often we hold ourselves accountable for so many things, and it's time to let us off our own hook and say, Lord, I choose to forgive me for what I've done. And you may actually feel that there's some people that don't deserve your forgiveness. Well, there's that feelings thing. We talk about this in Kindling. We have one triad, which is a group of three, and we're doing some prayer ministry, and we've talked over and over and over about the fact that there's the three F's. There's the fact of what God says. There's faith, believe in that, and then there's feeling. They come at the end. But most of us, if we're not letting God run this life of ours, so often we're driven by our feelings. And then our belief system will go generally towards what our feelings are, and faith, or fact, seems to go out the window. And what God has said is, look, what I said, I meant. And I can take God at face value, so the reading of his word is very, very important. Take his word at face value. I'm going to believe what God said. My feelings will catch up. And right now, they're all over the place because of what's happened to me in my past. But as I choose to follow after the truth of what God says and believe that God is who he says he is and will do what he says he will, my feelings will catch up. And the joy of the Lord will be your strength. Okay? So it's so important for us to recognize that forgiveness is a choice, not a feeling. Who do we need to forgive first? Probably the person who's hurt you most. Step three is, now it's time to get to work. Because it's one thing for us to write out that list, but if we do nothing with the list, we've done nothing. So now it's time to get to work. Well, how do we do that? Well, we begin with prayer. What's the prayer look like? It starts with this prayer. Lord Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross that I may be forgiven. I'm sorry for my own sins, and I ask you to be my Savior and the Lord of my life. Now please forgive me for the things that I have done wrong. Please help me to forgive all the people on my list from my heart. So that's setting us up now for this time of forgiving other people. Lord, forgive me. Anybody that hasn't made any bad decisions? In counseling, lots of times, I wish God would give me just the spot where there's an on-off switch there where I can just turn people's free will off for a while and make some good choices for them. He won't let me. Why? Because we've got free will, and God wants us to choose willingly to follow after him. So now we're at this stage. So now it's time for us to take each one of those names on our list and to prayerfully go through them. Each one, I figure it's time to do these individually. If they hurt us individually, let's not make it a big gang of people who are going to just do a simple prayer and be done with it. But rather, Lord, I choose to forgive my dad for, and you go right down the list of your headlines, and I choose to set him free. And I want to release him. So each name, in some situations, I've had people say, well, I've got a full stack paper right full. I said, that's okay. We've got time. But that's, folks, this is all this is putting out the garbage. That's all it is we're setting it up so that God can put out the garbage. So just one at a time, let's get them done and deal with them. What's the prayer? The prayer goes this way. I now choose to forgive, put the name in, whoever it is you're forgiving, for what he or she did to me. The brief description, headline it. And I release him or her into the freedom of my forgiveness. I will not hold these things against them anymore. That's the prayer. It may come out of clenched teeth at the first time. That's okay, keep praying. Because it's so important that we do this. So that's step three. We go right through that whole list of people that we have to forgive. And we forgive them step by step. Now step four. Step four is so important because now what we're asking God to do is come and unhook the chain from my neck. Lord, would you set me free? And it's because of the fact that when we've been offended, there's been a wounding in our spirit, and we need to ask God to come and do a healing work in there, because it has changed how we've looked at the world, it's changed how we've looked at God, it's changed how we respond to other people. So as we forgive that person, that's fine, but the damage was still done, and we need to ask God to come and do a healing work with that, where that damage was. So because my father rejected me in so many ways, in word at least, in names and whatnot, then I had a view of God that every time I did something wrong, I would get to stomp upon me. He wasn't a loving, generous father, but rather was a militant God who was going to stomp on me for everything I did wrong. I had a wrong view of God. But when I asked God to forgive me, and when I asked God to do a healing work in me, and I chose to forgive my dad, he gave me a different view. First of all, my natural dad, he gave me a different view of who God is. And so we find out that God wants to do a healing work inside of us. Step four, then, is it's now to pray. You can either do this after each individual, if you like, or you can clump this one all together afterwards. And the prayer is like this. Thank you, Lord, for helping me to forgive, you know, this person or all these people on my list. I ask you now that you will set me free from every ungodly influence that they have had on my life and cut the ropes that have held me tightly to the pain of my past. Lord, come and heal me on the inside where I have been damaged because of this. So important. Step five. This is where we forgive God. God didn't do anything wrong, but we can blame him for things that have gone wrong in our lives. And Lord, where were you when this happened? Where were you when that happened? And so we can blame him for his lack of presence or his lack of love in the middle of our trials. And the prayer is very simple here. Lord, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, God, for blaming you for the bad things that have happened in my life. I now know you didn't want these things to happen either. Please forgive me. Pretty simple, right? But we're just saying, God, I recognize that I blamed you and I shouldn't. Forgive me. Well, something happened. Step six. This is the ultimate prayer of forgiveness, and it brings us back to the cross. What do we say from the cross? We say that Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. The step six for us now is, Father, Forgive them. They don't know what they did. And so often that's the case, is that people will respond to us and hurt us out of their own hurt. One of the things we learned a while back is that hurt people, you understand that? And when people are damaged, they can't help but damage other people. So basically, if you've got somebody that's living with a lot of rejection in their life, don't be a bit surprised that partway into a relationship, they start pushing you away. Because they're going to push you away before you get a chance to push them away. So hurt people, hurt people. And so what we need to do then is in this step six, is ask God to, basically you're praying saying, Lord, I'm not going to hold anything against them any longer. And if you wanted to, you could actually go to the step farther. This is hard, folks. Lord, as far as I have concern, or as far as I have anything to do with it, I'm asking you, Lord, that you don't hold this sin against them any longer either. That's between God and that person. But what you're saying, as far as I'm concerned, this is over. And Father, I would just assume that you didn't hold this against them either. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they did. Now that's a big step. And actually, friends, what that is that's intercessory forgiveness. When you start praying for somebody who's hurt you, and you pray that kind of, Father, forgive them, and don't hold that against them any longer, you're now setting the Holy Spirit free to start to work in their lives. You're getting out of the way. You no longer are holding that claim of justice against them. Yeah, but you don't know what they did. They deserve. It doesn't matter, Lord. I'm so sick and tired of holding on to this. I'm going to forgive them. And Lord, I ask that you would forgive them too. It's a big step. Final step is resurrection morning. It's time to discard the old grave clothes. It's time to stop reacting the way that we used to react because of the hurt and the pain that was deep inside. There is a resurrection morning coming for you as well. God will bring healing into our spirit as you and you will begin to have different feelings. They will start to catch up with the decisions, the godly decisions that we've made. But if we keep holding on to the hurt, if we keep holding on to the pain, then the godly feelings of the joy of the Lord has been replaced by that claim of justice, by that bitterness and the resentment that's deep inside of us. Allow God to change your sorrow into dancing. And we can rejoice even though people have hurt us in the past. Let me conclude. We're to practice forgiveness just as Christ displayed it from the cross. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. And he's asked us to do the same thing. We're to be Christ in the middle of a world that does not know Christ. And so when we start to walk in forgiveness, then people are going to see a difference in us. And they're going to see the very character of Christ being developed within us. And the joy of the Lord rising up within us. It's a choice. It's not based on feelings. It's a conscious choice that we make. I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. Now, Lord, I make this choice to forgive. And we forgive in order to be set free from our bitterness. That's probably the most wonderful benefit there is to walking in forgiveness, is that no longer do they have that control over us, that now we're free. And God's going to bring healing into your spirit as we become obedient to him. I know it's been a heavy teaching time this morning, but perhaps there's some that need to walk in forgiveness. Perhaps there's some that haven't started this journey yet. And today you could actually pray that yes of yeses. Lord, as you reveal to me the people that I need to forgive, I say yes already. I'm going to start this journey. If that's you, why don't you just pray that out to them? You can do that from where you're at. Or if you want to make it more significant for yourself, not necessarily for other people, but for yourself, you can come to the altar and do that. The altar is always available for that. We're going to sing a song in closing before we do that. Father, we want to come to you. We recognize that from the cross you spoke those very first words, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. And Lord, what you did when you spoke those words, you modeled for us how we too could be free. Lord, set us free that we may follow after you. We give you thanks in Jesus' name.